Hey, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Stop Doing Nothing TV here with Patrick Ullman. Today, I am very delighted to have a great author and a great speaker, but someone who I consider a personal friend and not only someone who's part of my inner circle, but like my inner circle. On your screen right here, you're seeing Jill Schiffelbein from The Dynamic Communicator, and she is coming to us live today from New York City, and I'm very jealous. So good morning, Jill. How are you doing today?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me, Patrick.
My pleasure. There are many reasons I wanted to have Jill on. Number one, I'm a big fan of hers because of her communication skills and because she's an insanely popular YouTuber. Last time I checked, you were close to like a million views on YouTube. Is that right?
750,000. I'm getting there.
750,000. But Jill also has something very exciting coming out. We're recording this in the middle of February, but in less than 30 days, actually 30 days minus 2 days, Jill has something very exciting coming out. Jill has a new book come out. So Jill, can you take a couple of seconds here and tell us about what's coming up in March?
On March 14th, I am so flipping excited to have my next book come out. It's called Dynamic Communication, 27 Strategies to Grow, Lead, and Manage Your Business. And it's done through Entrepreneur Press, the same company that does Entrepreneur Magazine. So I am beyond excited for this to happen.
It's very cool because Jill has a great partnership with Entrepreneur. And if you haven't had a chance yet, follow the Entrepreneur fan page and Jill's personal site on Facebook because she is like their queen of live streams. So this woman kills it on video. Real quick, I just want to, just so people get to know a little bit about you, a lot of people that come into the area that we're in, like public speaking or communication, just for some reason just fly off the wall, all of a sudden they land here. But you've got a history, and one of the things I think I like about you that a lot of people don't know is you're a university professor at some point in time. And whenever I first met you, I was like, goodness gracious, she's so young. And people think that about you, but you're an actual like university professor who was in front of classes in Arizona, correct?
Yeah. It's funny. If you trace back to, you know, I'll do long story short as much as I can. 16-year-old Jill was aiming to get a scholarship because my parents told 9-year-old Jill in small town Kansas that if I ever wanted to leave, I had to get a full ride scholarship. So what did I do? I went to the library and looked up what scholarship was because I had no clue. And there were libraries at that point in time. So did that, realized what I needed to do. And then everything I did in high school was aimed towards this. And through all these leadership experiences I was fortunate enough to have, I started speaking on stages when I was 16.
Wow.
By the time I graduated, I had spoken in front of a crowd of 5,000 people, and I fell in love with words. So when I went to college at Arizona State University in the Hugh Downs School, I was going to be a motivational speaker and leadership conference facilitator in Spanish-speaking third world countries for youth.
Wow, that's a mouthful right there.
It is. And I'm one of those weird people who actually majored in what they set out to major in. But I quickly found out that 4 years of high school Spanish in Kansas didn't mean crap when it came to Spanish in the real world, and realized that that wasn't a skill that I thought I had. But I ended up falling in love with the business aspect of it, graduated, and then was offered a full ride for graduate school. And because it happened to have a shortage of public speaking teachers, and by then I already had a vast amount of experience, I actually got to start teaching at the university at the age of 22. And I did it for 11 years. So it was an incredible journey. I'm so grateful for it. And I fell in love with not only words and communication, but educating. And I've now just found a way to take my passion for education outside of the academic world and apply it to business.
Cool. I think you're out of my network, I think you're the only actual person who's been a university professor. So that's pretty cool. For some reason, I consider it, it boosts my ego that I know a real live university professor. So that turned into the business that you have now, which is a dynamic communicator. And can you kind of share with us a little bit, what is it that Jill helps other people with or other businesses with? We're going to talk about the book here in a little bit, but I want people to know, like, if, because communication to me can mean anything. We're communicating right now. Mm-hmm. You're communicating when you're ordering ordering a sandwich, but what is it that you really help other people or other businesses with on a day-to-day basis?
you know, when I first started a business 5 years ago, I was operating under another name, Impromptu Guru, and my goal was to help people speak well anytime and every time. I was basically a presentation and public speaking and media coach, right? Right. So anytime you were getting in front of audiences, I could help you prepare for that. What I found through that is that a lot of people see communication as the ability to speak well and be articulate or to write a grammatically correct sentence. But having those skills in an organization doesn't guarantee success or doesn't drive results. And I became more fascinated by kind of the common perception that that's what good communication was versus what I know to be true. Mm-hmm. And so I kind of pushed that business on the side. It still does, you know, passive revenue things, but I really wanted to focus on more strategic communication, what I call dynamic communication, which is communicating for results. It's not about having this perfect message. It's not about being able to get on stage without uttering or making a slip up in your words, because quite frankly, that doesn't matter one darn bit in the majority mm-hmm. of situations in life. Okay. What matters is your ability to actually drive action and get results from your words. So the Dynamic Communicator, as a company, we focus on really crafting strategic communication to help companies derive results. And most of them are consumer facing in terms of how do we get consumers to understand our project better? How do we better communicate to educate so that people are using our products more effectively?
Got it. Very cool. So you're building this dynamic communicator empire. And by the way, because I don't rave about all my guests, but I've actually had the pleasure of seeing Jill speak in the past 60, 90 days or so. Jill came to NSA, Texas, and I got to see her live, and she had a room captivated. So she is the lady that kind of basically eats her own dog food when it comes to communication. So you've built this company now, and you've been working on this book for a while. So can you tell us a little bit about what we can expect? You know, what kind of things are in the book? What kind of people did you talk to in the book? And how you were, to me, you got this book on relative to other people who can kind of drag their feet. You use some tricks and things to get this book done a little bit fast. And we can also talk about a little bit about who you got to forward the book, because that's also pretty
You know, it's been this amazing journey, and, you know, I know this is the stop doing nothing show, right? So the first piece of advice in relation to business earlier is don't wait until you feel you have the absolute perfect business plan to get started. Get started with what you know you're capable of doing in that moment, like I did with my first business. And then as you learn more about who you are and what you really want to do and the best ways you add value and serve people, you can course correct, or not even course correct, but adjust your path midway. That's the beauty of being an entrepreneur. So it's better to start somewhere. And with this book, that's exactly what I did. I started somewhere where I thought it needed to go. And I submitted, so full timeline for people thinking about this. Now, I've done an academic book, so I have a published textbook that took forever in a day. I don't ever care to do that route again. I have a self-published book, which from I'm going to do this to it was physically in hands and ready to be sold in less than 30 days. And that included all formatting, all cover design, all editing, all everything. Namely, because I cocked off to a former NFL player and said, I can speak better than people you have at this event. I want to speak at the Super Bowl. And he said, yeah, right. We'll get a book. I said, I'll have it to you in 30 days. He said, yeah, right. And so I gave it to him. And next year I spoke at the Super Bowl event. You know, it's
very cool. Cool.
You know, you got to be motivated to do something
Don't
like that.
Put a challenge in front of Jill. That's all I'm wanting right here, because they'll just come over the top like a wrecking ball on you.
You know, all Miley Cyrus, exactly. So it's this book was meant to really be like the first real book. Not that those other ones aren't real, and not that self-publishing isn't real, because I know some people who really kill it in that space. But this is the first book where there is another company that's saying, we want you. And only you, Jill, to put yourself on paper to give our audience and let them become your audience something of value. And we are going to sell you, and we are going to sell your book. Mm-hmm. And that is just very different to me. Because with the academic press, you have a built-in audience. There are universities that are kind of contracted to use your materials. Self-publishing, for me, it was to reach one goal, to get into this speaking event, and I did. So I consider that a success, even though the sales were like 300, 400 whole copies. That was never my goal. But with this book, I'm like, okay, 10, 15, 20, 30, 40,000 copies. Let's get these puppies moving, because someone else put their trust and their money behind me, which holds me way more accountable than anything I'll ever do just on my own.
Right.
So I started this process in, I want to make sure I get the timeline right, of October of 2015. One of my tricks for writing or doing anything is to get myself out of my norm. Mm-hmm. And so what did I do? Because I like to go to extremes. I took myself on a cruise. And
jealous. Hello.
You know, but a last minute fare, I spent $1,200 on the entire trip, including my bar bill, including the cruise fare, including all incidentals, some snorkeling on the side, zip lining, all those fun things. But that was the best $1,200 I invested in myself, because in that week, I put together an entire book proposal. And I'm talking a 50-page proposal where you have two sample chapters, a fully fleshed out outline, a 10-page plus marketing plan.
Right.
If you're going to publish with a publisher, you need to be able to demonstrate your ability in this marketing plan to sell 10,000 copies within a year. So that's taking a ton of time and planning into this document. And I wrote what I thought was the most brilliant book proposal, and it was called The Communication Equation. Note that I said it was called.
Right.
Because that's not the title of my book. So it was October 2015. It took until April of 2016 to get the confirmed offer. So I got an offer with an advance. It took 2 months after that to get all the negotiations on my part, on their part, the lawyers, all that hammered out.
Right.
And in June 2016, I finally started putting pen to paper, and on July 15th, handed in my first three chapters.
Wow. So this was, so how many, so exact, so about how many, now was that, are you, I want to talk a little bit about the I guess the technique that you used. Was that actually all like fingers to keys, or how do you get a little bit more stuff done? Because I know I personally have a lot of trouble just actually sitting down and writing. Is that what you did, or how did you get the process of getting words to ink?
Well, this is a funny story. Those three chapters, I sat down and wrote. Fingers, keyboards, and after those three chapters, so in about 30 days, put out three chapters, I talked to my publisher, and I said, I don't think this is a book. And she said, tell me more. And I said, I think I need to do a, you know, this is like a 50, like a, you know, nitty gritty, we're going way up in the clouds. Only a certain level of reader is going to want to sift through all this, because I'm in love with my methodology and what I think I know.
Right.
And what I know as well. But I didn't, I talked to her and I said, you know what? I don't know if this is the book for the masses. I think this is more the book for me. And I threw out a whole other idea. And she said, great, I love it. So on August 1st, I started conceptualizing now.
Yeah.
An entire new book around communication still that was due in full in 60 days.
So August, so it would be the 1st of October.
Yep, 1st of October. And my writing process is this. I decided, forget this one big theorem, this one big methodology, this one big model that I conceptualized and still to this day I'm very damn proud of, but it's just not the right time for it.
Right.
I said, I'm going to come up with 20-something, I didn't know the number, different strategies across all different areas of communication. It's going to be like the survey of communication, this textbook that students really wish they had, but they're never going to get at a university because there's too many ivory tower mentalities there. This is a teaching I really want to do. And I'm going to, you know, this is going to be great. I started writing it.
Okay.
30 days into writing it, all I had was a couple of chapters and an outline.
Wow.
And I was stumped because I didn't have this framework. And then after that, I said, forget this. I need to, again, take myself out of it. So I started walking in the park. I live by Central Park. I consider myself very fortunate for that. And instead of sitting down and writing, because that clearly wasn't working,
right?
I put my headphones in that have a little, you know, Bluetooth receiver. Well, this one doesn't, but a right. little microphone in it. And I would walk in the park and voice dictate a chapter. I said, wow. In this hour walk, I am going to voice dictate a chapter. And every single day I would go out, I would walk about 4 or 5 miles in the park, and I would voice dictate a chapter. I would come back then that afternoon, and then I would edit it, because obviously there's going to be many errors in that right. voice translation. I would edit it down, and by the end of the day, a chapter was done. And I started doing this process over and over again. And for me, who tends to get in my own head, and if anyone else there does this too, you get in your own head and you think you have to sound smarter than what you really do.
Right.
Because you don't need to write at this super high academic, like, I need to use these verbose BS words level. Mm-hmm. You need to actually write more often in the way you speak. And so this was the best exercise for me. By doing that, I was able to edit it, get it done, pump out a chapter a day, sometimes right. multiple chapters in a day. And then the other thing I did for some chapters was I looked at existing speeches or programs that I had done.
Right.
I got those transcribed using a service called rev.com. And Patrick, you're the one who actually turned me on to them. It's rev.com. And damn it, they don't have affiliate programs or we would both be rich by now.
Exactly.
You know, it's $1 a minute and it happens so fast. So I sent all these programs off to be transcribed. I copied and pasted what was useful and put it into a chapter and then filled the rest in around it.
Mm-hmm.
And so within 30 days, I had a book.
Wow.
But there's a twist in that, if I'm allowed okay. to talk about
there's
it.
There's always a twist.
But wait, there's more.
You don't do anything like straight line. When they say the zigzag, you are the epitome sometimes of not taking the straight path or something. So I'm curious to hear this now. I think I might know what's coming, but I always want to get Jill.
I think you do. And this is, to me, where the real stroke of brilliance came in. After I had all the chapters outlined, after I had about 60% of them written,
right.
I looked at what I had and I said, you know what? This isn't enough. And I called my editor and I said, I have this amazing idea. You're going to love it. And by mm-hmm. now she's sick of me zigging and zagging too. And she's right. like, all right, Jill, what is it now? And I said, how about I bring in 27 amazingly brilliant people from all different industries, all different parts of entrepreneurship, some people who work in corporate who think like entrepreneurs, and do a featured interview from each of them in the book. And she said, oh my God, I love it. But you still need to do it in that time frame.
Right.
I'm like, can I have 2 extra weeks? And she said, okay, 2 extra weeks. So now I'm looking at finding,
mm-hmm.
interviewing, doing 20 to 30 minute interviews, getting those transcribed, getting those truncated down now to 500 word pieces from about a 7,000 word interview,
right.
making sure they match with the content existing in the book, because of course the smart thing to do would have been done the interviews and craft around them, but oh no, I was not that smart. I reverse engineered that puppy and I managed to do all of that within a 30 day period. And that was the most unhealthy and most productive time of my life.
Did you do literally 27 interviews in 30 days? Mm-hmm. Was this like weekends also, or is this multiple interviews a day, or was just whenever and wherever you could book people, you got it done?
I did almost all of them in a 2-week period, multiple interviews a day. I would sit up, I would do an interview, I would try to schedule 30 minutes between each one, hit the record button, stop the record, get it rendered, send it off to rev.com. By the time I was done with the next interview, sometimes that transcript would come back while I was waiting between interviews, I'd edit them down.
Right.
It was this, I don't know that I've ever worked so hard on something so quickly in my life. And, you know, I have 10 extra pounds to show for it, because man, when you're up working, you want Butterfingers and you want Dr. Pepper. And for me, this book baby wanted Indian food all the time. And since uh-huh. I live in New York, I can get it 24/7. So it was like a comedy of errors.
Delivered to you also. That's the weird part. You don't have to go anyplace. It just can be on your doorstep.
I'm just like sitting on my couch, typing away, transcribing away. And oh my gosh, it was really a blur. But here's the deal. Most people are motivated by a deadline.
Right.
And what I've also learned about myself is if someone else is depending on you, if someone else has invested in you and put money in you, you are going to work your butt off to meet that deadline more so than any deadline you ever set for yourself.
Right.
And so now that I've translated that into other things that I do, I will make promises in my business, say mm-hmm. I'm launching things on a certain date, even when they are not built yet, because I know now that people are subscribed or signed up or counting on it, I am now held accountable to someone other than me. And right. I think that is the single biggest secret for me to stop doing nothing and stop delaying.
So do you think that, do you do a lot of public accountability where you say, I'm going to, you'll hop out on social media or you'll discuss with maybe a small group of friends? Because I know you're very involved in masterminding also. Do you publicly declare that to people and then, like you did the book, kind of work backwards and figure out how the heck you're going to do it after you declare it?
Yeah, I mean, the next thing that I am launching is called the Dynamic Accelerator. I have the URL, but there is an empty page up there right now. And yeah, you know what? When my book releases March 14th, that is on the back cover. So I got to get that done and ready. That is the biggest accountability thing for me, because if anyone checks it out, I'm missing out on money.
Right.
And I, you know, the publisher would look like an idiot if something is on the book that they put out and it didn't exist. So for me, I hold myself accountable by saying these things are going to be done mm-hmm. and publicizing them in a way that really, bearing any unforeseen circumstances, I am going to do.
Right. Got it. So the book's done. You've got all these interviews. I just did the math really quick in my head. That's 2 weeks, 10 days. That's 2 to 3-ish interviews a day. Which I'm right now lucky to get like one interview done a week. So you're knocking these out 2 to 3 times a day. So the book's all done. Not all done, but in the process of editing it. And I know one of the most important parts of the book is the beginning or the people who endorse it for you.
Yeah.
So I know you, again, since you shoot big on everything, tell us your thought process of how you got someone to write the foreword for you. Because to me, it sounds a little bit scary. But I'd like to hear the process and let you reveal who you ultimately ended up talking to make this happen for you.
You know what was interesting in even asking people for the interviews? So I'll rewind just a second. Even okay. asking people for the interviews, I reached out to people who I had maybe seen once, who may have never even heard of my name. And right. I am fortunate that almost everyone who I wanted to interview has heard of Entrepreneur Magazine. So I had that card to play, and I'm very fortunate for having that card to play.
Cool.
And I reached out to these people thinking there's no way people are going to say yes, because these are people who are making tons of money, and not that success is all about money at all, right. but there are people playing at a big level. And they all invested their time in me. I mm-hmm. had very few people say no. And the ones that did were mainly because of scheduling.
Right.
I only had one person that I reached out to not even respond back. Mm-hmm. And that blew my mind. And I thought, holy cow. And during the course of this, and I want to share this story to hopefully inspire some people, because it really inspired me.
Right.
When I asked one of these people who has 2 New York Times best-selling books, who is younger than me, who is right. freaking brilliant, a couple weeks after I interviewed him, he invited me to this small networking event that he hosted. And I asked him, I said, you know, super awesome rock star person who I admire. I said, I am so appreciative for what you've done. And he said to me, you know, I think the most important thing in life is when you achieve a certain level of success, that you help other people who you feel are worthy also achieve that same level of success.
Uh-huh.
And I'm not often speechless, but I just kind of sat there with my jaw open, because the biggest thing that hit me is every single person who invested time in this mm-hmm. feels I am worthy in some way. And if everyone who's listening thinks back to times that someone invested time in you, it's because they also thought you were worthy. Mm-hmm. And if you really think of that, it is overwhelming, and it really gives you motivation to keep on moving, because I think, wow, I'm not an ass. People actually see me as someone who contribute value at a, you know, at a higher level, whatever. Right. And it blew my mind, but let me tell you, when I asked them to do the interviews, it was one thing because I said, when you do the interviews, a video excerpt will be featured on entrepreneur.com. Right. Well, not too many people at any level of success are going to turn that down. Right. I was very lucky to have that card. When it came to asking for testimonials and endorsements, though,
right.
I'm like, oh my God, I feel like the most pompous ass, I hope I can say that here, doing this.
It's all good.
Because I'm writing these people like, hey, here's a couple sample chapters in the book and here's the table of contents, but would you write an endorsement? And again, 14 endorsements within 48 hours of these being asked.
Gosh.
From people who I'm just mind blowing. And then I realized they've all been there as authors. Mm-hmm. They've been there and they know. So when you're taking on a project, surround yourself with people who have been there and know. But for me, writing the forward and getting someone to write the forward was the mm-hmm. scariest freaking thing I did. And Patrick knows this because in this little small group that we share in common, mm-hmm. I was saying, guys, I know who I want to ask to do my forward. And this guy is a multiple times New York Times bestselling author,
right.
has built his own media company that rivals in viewership those of major publications, is an angel investor, is a freaking generous soul beyond belief. And I'm thinking, there is no way in hell he's going to do this for me. But if I don't ask, I will always regret it.
Right.
So I crafted this email and I looked at it and I was so freaking nervous. And I clicked send, asking him to write the foreword. Well, I had done this on my phone initially and copied and saved it in a draft and copied and pasted it. Well, my phone auto-corrected forward to forward, F-O-R-W-A-R-D. So I realized that I just made my biggest ask of my life with grammatically incorrect words.
Oh.
I was so mortified. And I didn't read it again. Like, and that's totally on me. My bad, my fault, because I misspelled F-O-R-E-W-A-R-D when I was typing fast.
Right.
And boom. It went to forward instead of forward as in a book. I'm like, oh my God, I'm such an idiot. And I never heard from him.
Uh-huh.
I'm thinking, oh my God, I'm freaking out. I feel like a moron. Very long story short, I've already rambled on enough. I emailed him back and he freaking said yes.
Oh, wow.
And Jay Baer, B-A-E-R, for those of you who don't know him, look him up. You'll just be like, holy crap, this dude is amazing.
Right.
Wrote this forward for my book. And when he sent it to me, I literally cried. And he had taken so much time and effort in crafting this and lending his name to it. So I can't believe what would have happened if I wouldn't have asked.
Right.
And that is just the biggest lesson in stopping doing nothing is one, hold yourself accountable to other people. But two, the worst you're going to hear is no. And as much as that stings sometimes, and believe me, I'm single and dating in New York. I've heard no a lot. I've also said no a lot, in all fairness.
Sorry, I'm laughing at that. But single and dating in New York, Patrick, I've heard no. I'm sorry. That was a real life LOL there.
It is. You know, I've heard no a lot. I've said no a lot. But it may sting, but the possibilities that you have in life and business when you don't even ask, you're letting them pass you by. And I'm so filled with gratitude and thanks and gratefulness for everyone who was involved with this, for you, Patrick, for letting me tell the story and share it. It's just, it's an amazing thing that can happen. And this is me. This is like one single person in my business. I'll hire a contractor when I need, but this is done a single person, which means anyone can freaking do this. I'm a small town Kansas girl who knows how to milk a cow, for crying out loud. This is doable by anybody.
Wow. That was, I've talked to you a lot about the book over the months. And even now I'm just learning about some of the processes you went through and the pains and the struggles. And I'm not even sure I knew about the tears that happened when Jay got back to you. He's a great guy. Actually, someplace over here in my desk drawer, I have a Jay Baer, one of those big steel, bottle openers for beer. I mean, that's the one thing I remember about Jay is he gives those out to very special people. And the first time I met him, he gave me one. So the man has a huge heart. And I just really can't wait to read. Now, was he interviewed for the book also? Or mm-hmm. did he just do the forward?
No, he was also interviewed for the book. And it ended up working out that his interview fit best with the first chapter. So it was amazing. It Yeah, I could not be more happy with it. And if people want to get their hands on the foreword that made me cry, and it probably won't make anyone else cry, but I was so emotionally charged and overwhelmed with his graciousness that I was a sappy mess. You know, you can actually get the table of contents, the preface, the foreword, and the introduction and the first chapter of the book free as a sneak peek right now.
Nice. And I mean, this is a good time to mention this. So we have some good segues going on. Every book has a website. And since we have the launch coming up, if people want to get an early preview of some of this stuff, how can they get these from you?
Yeah, go to dynamiccommunicationbook.com.
Right.
Pretty obvious URL, but Dynamic Communication Book. You can learn all about the book, the project, and you can also, you can pre-purchase. Well, I can link you to Amazon, Barnes & Noble, IndieBooks, whatever, to pre-purchase the book, which I'm grateful for, but that's not, you know, the whole pitch here. But moreover, if you want to see my style of writing to see if it would vibe for you, and it doesn't vibe for everyone, and I know that.
Right.
If it vibes with you, then you can sign up on the website. There'll be like two or three different pop-up things, because that's what good marketers do, those opt-in things. And you can sign up and you'll get immediate access. Like, I don't even email you it. You sign up and then boom, there's a download link that pops up on the screen for you. You can click on it right there and get immediate sneak peek access to the book.
Cool. Now, one thing I want to cover before we wrap up here a little bit is you mentioned that in addition to the book, you've got like a course or some training coming on afterwards. And I know you're still working on that. Mm-hmm. I know if somebody wants to improve the communication skills, obviously reading those 27 tips in the book are going to do that, but what's the course going to give them in addition to that?
So it's not even a course, actually. It's a community. Okay. And it's an accelerator program where it's a monthly fee. It's incredibly low from my point of view. It's $49. So anyone who's actually serious about something, $49 a month is nothing.
Right.
But my idea with this community is to put me out there one too many and to give as much value as I can. And how the program will work is every Monday morning. And if you're not awake at that point in time because you're on the West Coast or in another part of the world, whatever, because I'm on the East Coast, it's recorded. But every Monday morning, I will give you in 30 minutes. I don't think there's some like prize to be won for saying you get an hour or 2 hours of training every week, because if I can accomplish in 30 minutes what others can in an hour or 2 hours, I am a better value.
Got
so
it.
You get 30 minutes of a live tutorial, lesson, education, whatever it is. And in that 30 minutes, you actually get action steps, strategies, and plans to implement that one communication change in your business that week.
Okay.
And of course, there's a Facebook group of members only where you can share what you're doing, where you can run ideas past other people, including me,
who's,
you know, moderating that Facebook group. But the idea is so many people pick up books and read them. So many people watch trainings, but don't do crap with them. I call it the law of diminishing marginal motivation. The further away you get from a training or reading, and this is actually in the book, the further away you are from actually implementing it. So my idea is anyone who wants to stop doing nothing and who wants to get shit done, you sign up. And every Monday morning, here's 30 minutes. Start off your Monday while you're watching your coffee with this plan, and then schedule out how you're going to implement the 3 to 5 steps every week. It's basically like a business accelerator coach in your pocket.
Right. Very cool. And that's going to be kind of launched in March, right around the book, correct?
April 3rd, the first Monday in April, will be the first official lesson, if you will, but registration for the program will start in March, and there will be some bonus and discount offers, of course, associated with the book coming out.
Good deal. So kind of recap and kind of bring this kind of full circle. So we've got a book launch March 4th, what is it right here? It's March 14th, is that right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, book launch. You know what? It's actually kind of funny. Because Jill is such a close personal friend, I kid you not, if I were to swing my computer up here, there's a calendar up here, and the March 14th is highlighted on my calendar. Jill's name is on my calendar up here on March 14th. And she's going to have a big launch in New York City, and then you're going to have the follow-on community. I've got a lot of thoughts going on in my head here. As we're kind of wrapping up here, do you think that there's one particular part of the book that you are proud of? I mean, I know the entire thing is your book, baby, but out of the 27 things, and we've talked about Jay Bear and the forward and everything you've done, is would you say there's maybe a particular point or a particular chapter in the book that you are more proud of, or that you think just kind of developed in a way you didn't expect to develop?
You know, one of the thing that I am most proud of is something that I actually, it was in my mind and I was conscious of it, but it wasn't at the forefront until actually Jay pointed it out in the foreword.
Right.
And he basically wrote 6 reasons why I'm recommending this book to people.
Uh-huh.
And one of them was that it was organized in different parts.
Uh-huh.
Instead of just themes, it was specific parts, and you don't necessarily need all parts at the same time or at any one point in time in your business. But he said it was the first book that he's seen that was organized in this way. And for me, my idea was not to go deep into one topic, but to literally give a whole survey of what you could do in terms of communication. So whatever challenge you're facing, whether it's growth challenges, whether it's leadership challenges, or whether it's management challenges,
right,
there's a part in the book that you can go to. And for me, it was about writing the book so that people could identify whatever problem they're having. They go to the table of contents, find the chapter that addresses that problem, open to that chapter, and you can take away value by reading one single chapter. You don't have to read the whole book. And that's what I'm most proud of. I mean, there's spoiler alerts and flashbacks, like if you didn't understand the concept, but
right,
I am so proud that realistically, very few people pick up a book and read it from cover to cover. People
right,
read it until it gives them one good idea to solve a problem. And then hopefully they implement it, but most of the time they don't.
Exactly how I do it, right.
For me, I have this book, I'm having a problem, I go look at it. A month later, when there's a different problem, I pull that book off the shelf and holy crap, there's another different strategy that can help. And it's almost like a reference guide, but it covers the gamut of communication for any business owner or any manager in a mm-hmm. business. And that's what I'm most proud of.
Very cool. I'm not going to say it's like 27 mini books, but it's not like a fiction book that's necessarily meant, you don't have to read it from front to back to get the value out of it. You can start with number 27 and go to 2 and then 15 and 18 if you want. That's brilliant. That actually gives me some ideas for when writing a book, or that should actually give other people an idea when they're considering writing a book, is don't make it something that has to be completely consumed to be of value. If I was to go into Jill's book and literally rip out chapter five by itself would make sense. It would be valuable is what you're saying, right?
It would be. And, you know, like any book, if you read the introduction, it gives mm-hmm. it context. But
right,
even if you didn't, even if you said, screw this, I just want to go to the chapter, I think chapter 5 is death by sales script.
Okay.
So, you know, you're having problems with sales in your companies and your sales personnel aren't really hitting it on the mark. Or maybe you're not hitting on the mark because you're doing the same thing every time.
Right.
Well, go to this one chapter and you're going to get value. And what I do is, with spoiler alerts, if I mention a concept that I dive into in more depth in a future chapter,
right,
I shout it out. Likewise, if there's a concept mentioned that was mentioned in more detail in a previous chapter, I call that a flashback. So you have reference points on either end if you need to learn more.
Great stuff. So it sounds like one of those things where even when I get the book, I'm going to be going back and forth, because I'm just notorious when I open up a book. I will actually open up a random chapter. So my strategy will actually work when it comes to reading your book once it actually comes out here in the middle of March. I really don't even know if thank you kind of covers how much I appreciate you as a human being and your time. And I know you have a lot going on right now and your schedule is packed and everything in New York is an insane place to live anyways. And but really, I from the bottom of my heart, I really do appreciate your time. I've really enjoyed the process of you building this book, because I'm not going to say I've been involved. I mean, you're the mother. I am nowhere near in the hereditary of your book, but you know, I've been getting regular updates from you as part of our little group as to when things happen. And I'm just fascinated. There's a little bit of jealousy there, a little bit of envy, but also a lot of pride, the fact to know that I've known you from, you know, inception to the point now where there's physically going to be a book in your hand. So I'm very proud of that, the fact that you've done that, and I'm looking forward to seeing it. One last time, can you remind us about the book website and the book title And I know I'll just say it's March 14th in New York City, but I want people to get to this website and get on your email list to get the early previews.
Yeah, and just know, I'm not one of those people who sends a ton of email. I'm a shitty email marketer. I really, really am, right. And I don't do it well. So I only send out emails maybe once a month at most. It's really not much, but whenever I do, it's because there's actually something to add. There's so I promise, say, right. No crappy email or spamming, but if you go to dynamiccommunicationbook.com, you can sign up to get a sneak peek. And again, you enter your email because, of course, that's what you're supposed to do as a smart marketer. And I'm right. still figuring that part out. But you immediately, after you submit it, the download will get on the screen for you in a link. So you don't even have to go check your email. It's right. I wanted that. I wanted it simplified for people.
Very cool.
So dynamiccommunicationbook.com and the book Dynamic Communication 27, Strategies to Grow, Lead, and Manage Your Business in stores everywhere March 14th.
Very cool. Jill, again, thanks once again for your time, especially from New York. I always feel like it's cool when I get to interview somebody who's in like a famous, popular city. You know, I'm surprised you don't have like the New York skyline behind you and people.
I'm not at that pay level just yet. Just right. yet. You know, next year, let's do another interview this time next year, and we'll see the view being a little different.
Yeah. I mean, the book comes out March 14th, so who knows where you may be living March 15th. I mean, I'm sure it's going to rain on March 14th.
Thank you, Patrick. Once again,
thank you very much for the time. Everyone who's been watching, follow Jill on social media. She's got a fan page. She's got a profile. She's active on Twitter. And also make sure you, in addition to the stuff she has going on, you follow her on YouTube and pay attention to what she does on the Entrepreneur Network, because she is one of the better interviewers out there. And when she does live stuff on Entrepreneur Magazine, it is worth watching. I'm not going to say she was on the top of the roof for the New Year's ball and New Year's Eve with all the crystals in it, but she may have been. She may have been. I'll just put that out there. But go back through her timeline and you'll see that she's done some amazing stuff with Entrepreneur Magazine. So Jill, once again, good luck on the book launch. Congratulations on having your book baby come up on March 14th. And we'll hopefully get to talk to you maybe next year when your next book comes out.
Thank you so much, Patrick.
My pleasure.